regard to her bachelor's degree from Brown University and her advanced degrees from the University of California, Berkeley. After 21 years as a sociology professor at UCLA, where she directed the Institute for Research on Labor and Employment, she returned to New York City in 2010. She is currently a professor of sociology at CUNY Graduate Center and the Joseph P. Murphy Institute for Worker Education and Labor Studies, where she serves as academic director. Recently, she has written extensively about low-wage immigrant workers in the United States, analyzing their employment conditions as well as the dynamics of immigrant labor organizing. I am particularly interested in the new labor concept that forms the framework of her title today. In some ways, I suppose it means new labor as opposed to more traditional labor, but I will allow her to make those distinctions. And after her talk, Ruth has agreed to take questions from you, and please be reminded that she has brought some copies of her book for sale, if you are interested. So with that, I give you Ruth Milkman.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks so much for that lovely introduction. I have Labor Day, everybody. Thank you for coming on this long weekend. I have to say, I think a little shy. I've never set foot in this building before, but I didn't grow up in New York, but I used to hear about this place from my mother, who was very enamored of it, although she grew up here. I didn't. So anyway, I'm very happy to be here on multiple levels, and I see that her position has a really glorious history, which, so it's a pleasure to join you this morning. What I'd like to do this morning is, not very much time, is to tell you a little bit about the background of the inquiry that led to the book that's back there, share some highlights of what we learned, and then hear from you. As Joe said, I'm happy to do some Q&A at the end. In some ways, as David said, our musical prodigy over here in the corner mentioned before, today, we're in a period that in many ways is a throwback to earlier times in U.S. history. And I sort of want to start by saying a little bit about that, about the various changes that have occurred in the last few decades, then turn to the specific case in New York City, which is the backdrop for our study, and then tell you a little bit about what we found. When I say we, because this is an edited volume that I co-edited with a colleague at the Murphy Institute called Ed Ott, a name some of you may know if you follow labor developments here in New York City. He used to be the head of the Central Labor Council and has been at Murphy for several years now. And we co-edited the book. The chapters are case studies of different campaigns around New York City, and they were written by graduate students. So I'm not going to have time to share all the details with you. There's like 14 case studies in there, but I'll try to give you the big picture. And if you're curious, the book's available here or any usual places. So the first context is what I call resurgent market fundamentalism. Maybe you've heard that term, which I did not invent. The idea that, well, it's an appropriate thing to talk about here in a religious organization, that the market is the answer to everything. That kind of religious worship of the market. And as you probably are aware, for the last few decades here in the United States and in many other parts of the world as well, that's been the sort of reigning economic orthodoxy, only slightly disrupted by the 2008 financial crisis. I mean, it's still there, though under more challenge than before. And for purposes of understanding what's happening with workers or working people, there are really three broken systems of regulation. Broken because there is no longer a commitment to regulation on the part of the government, really. A lot of the laws that we have from the New Deal era are still on the books, but they're either not enforced properly or honored more than the breach than the observance. So the three I want to mention are labor relations, labor law, the NLRB system that worked for many decades but has been basically a disaster in recent years, the immigration system, and also labor standards embodied in things like minimum wage laws and more generally the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938, which again is still the law of the land but is observed, is often broken. So I'll just say to you that about each of those things to start with. As part of the decline of the NLRA, the Wagner Act, the 1935 law that created, that first gave workers the right to collective bargaining in this country.
Could you just talk a little more
slowly? Oh, okay. I'll try. in New York, I rarely get that complaint, but in California, I got it all the time, so I will try to oblige. Thank you. So I was going to say a little bit about the decline of traditional unions, as Joe mentioned. Our book is about what we call new labor. Sometimes it's called alt labor, new forms of organizing that are emerging in recent years, sometimes called worker centers, groups like the Restaurant Opportunity Center, perhaps you're familiar with that here in New York City, and many others which are mentioned there. Those groups have emerged against the background of the decline of traditional forms of unionism. And I'm sure you're all aware of this, but I'll just give you a couple numbers to remind you. In 2013, the last year for which we have data, private sector unionization rate in the United States was 6.8%. That's as low as it was in 1900. Unionization peaked in this country in the 1950s at a third of the labor force, just to give you an idea of how far things have fallen. And the standard explanation of this is to do with deindustrialization, outsourcing, globalization. Unfortunately, that's only a small part of the explanation. Because if you look at industries that can't leave, like say construction, there's been dramatic decline in union density in those sectors as well. So I'm not saying globalization is trivial or anything, but it's certainly not the whole story. The more important factor is both a really concerted attack on unionism by employers on the one side and a lack of government support for them on the other. Just again, so a little piece of evidence about the employer opposition to unionism. Between 1950 and 1990, the number of workers fired during organizing campaigns grew ninefold. It's illegal under the Wagner Act to fire somebody for union organizing. It happens every day. And there are remedies, but it takes years to implement. And meanwhile, the lesson that the fired person's coworkers learn is you do this, you get fired. There have been many attempts to bring about labor law reform, and they've all failed. Most recently, the Employee Free Choice Act that you may have heard about that was on the verge of passage in 2009, but did not. Also, you
pause it in the mic, please.
I'll try. Unions have also been basically demonized in our culture. So, I mean, people like myself who are very close to the labor movement are not affected by this. But if you look at what's out there in the mass media, you see frequent attacks on unions. One example is a recent book called The Worm in the Apple. That worm being teachers' unions.
Wow.
Anyway, I could go on, but I think you all know this. So the legitimacy of collective bargaining and labor organization is also under attack. It's not just that the numbers are down. It's not anymore considered a sort of mainstream form of activity. And public attitudes toward labor are increasingly negative, although that's a very polarized story, so it's really particularly true among Republicans and other right-wing folks. Okay, so now that's a dismal picture, I know, but I'm going to turn to an equally dismal one next, which is immigration. You probably are all aware that there are an estimated 11 million immigrants who live in the United States without documents. Under both Republican and Democratic administrations, there have been repeated efforts, all of which have failed, to bring about comprehensive immigration reform, despite enormous political incentives related to the growth of the Latino voting population. I think many of us expected that Obama would do something to address this, but that has not really occurred, with one important exception, which is DACA, the deferred action on childhood arrivals. So that really is significant. But there's a long way to go in terms of really addressing this crisis. And what we've seen is, he's become the deporter-in-chief as the advocates for immigration reform have labeled him. And meanwhile, deportations have been higher than ever in recent memory under Obama, along with arbitrary and capricious handling of individual cases. Meanwhile, many undocumented immigrants, and also some with papers, are trapped in low-wage jobs where they're vulnerable to wage theft and other abuses. Wage theft is the term that many of us use to describe employers who do not obey the law and pay workers less than the legal minimum wage, which is an extremely widespread practice, particularly for undocumented immigrants and particularly for women. I feel like I'm pressing everybody, but I'm going to get to a good part later. Okay. Another factor here is the growth of inequality in this country. I won't belabor it with statistics, but you probably all know about the craze about Thomas Piketty's new book, Capital in the 21st Century, which documents in enormous detail the growing concentration of wealth as well as income in this country, and unfortunately many others as well. More relevant maybe to our topic today, well, it's all relevant, but the minimum wage, which at the federal level remains stuck at $7.25 an hour, in real terms has not budged since the 1960s. That's half a century. So things are tough out there for working people in the United States. A number of us use the term precarious labor to describe the current predicament of many workers trapped at the bottom of the labor market. It's actually increasingly true for people in the middle layers as well, which is that employment security is a thing of the past. People do not know if they're going to be employed at whatever position they're in at the moment, if they are lucky enough to have one tomorrow. And that was always true to some extent in this country, but it's much more common today, partly because of union decline. Things like pensions have become an endangered species. Most young workers do not have anything resembling a pension. At best, they have access to a 401k plan or something like that, which most people can't afford to be part of. You all know about the growth in student debt, other kinds of debt. We've seen also dramatic declines in enforcement of existing bedrock labor standards that have, you know, been on the books for many, many years but are increasingly ignored by employers. Not just minimum wage laws, but overtime pay laws. Laws mandating breaks for lunch and rest periods are increasingly broken. I was part of a three-city study, and at the time I was in LA, but it was done here in New York as well as in Los Angeles and Chicago, where we found, we actually were able to measure the prevalence of those kinds of violations, and we ourselves were shocked by how much we found. Just one example. In our sample of 4,000 low-wage workers, which is a representative sample of those three cities at the bottom of the labor market. It's only the bottom 15% of the workforce that we studied. And within that group, 25% had been paid less than the minimum wage the previous work week. So that's 25% of 15%, not 25% of the workforce, but still a shocking number. And those numbers were much higher for immigrants and for women and for people of color. All right, so shifting gears for a minute, I wanted to say a little bit about New York City, which was the context for the book that we put together. New York City is quite exceptional, as you all know, in many ways. One of which is it has higher union density than any other major city in the country. There actually are a few state capitals here and there with very high public sector density that are a little higher, but they're small places. So it's roughly double the national average here in New York, but increasingly concentrated in the public sector, and also declining over time. Although, I will say some good news. At Murphy, we put out every year a Labor Day report on unionization rates in New York, and we're going to issue the next one on Tuesday, and I can give you a preview, which is that union density actually went up in this city a couple points in the last year. Not for the best reasons. I mean, it's mostly because of growth in sectors that were long ago unionized that have, you know, begun to rebound finally from the Great Recession, but still, it's a little piece of good news. New York also has what my colleague Josh Freeman, the historian, calls a social democratic legacy in this country, I mean, relative to any other major city, of you know, public provision of things like transportation, healthcare, public housing, things like that. New York is way ahead of most of the United States. However, it's also the site of vast and growing inequality in recent years, again, more than any other city. So there's a sort of contradictory story here. Much more inequality because the 1% like to live in New York, understandably. And at the same time, you know, much more organization up among workers. It's also, of course, always been and still is an immigrant gateway city. When my grandparents showed up here in the early 20th century, maybe some of yours, that was true, and it's true again today. Important for our story in the book, it's also the headquarters, more than any other place in the country, of philanthropy. which turns out to be quite important because many of the groups that we study only exist because of support from foundations and other forms of philanthropy. It also has the highest, not the highest, but Washington is the highest, but a very high concentration of lawyers, which is also important because lawyers are important actors in the struggles that many of these groups wage to get those laws that are broken all the time enforced and things like that. Okay, as you know, in this city, we've seen recently a pattern of extremely polarized job growth. So there are really great jobs down on Wall Street for those who can get them that pay, you know, vast salaries unimagined by many of the recipients until very recently. And steady growth at the bottom in low-wage retail, hospitality, and personal service jobs, which is what a lot of our case studies focus on. There is a sort of shrinking middle class, which is made up largely of union members nowadays, teachers, nurses, people like that. And just to add to the polarization, you may have heard about this, it's been written up in the New York Times quite regularly in recent times. In addition to having low hourly pay, many workers in sectors like restaurants and retail face short hours of work and unpredictable hours of work, which is a growing problem that's been facilitated by the new technology. So they find themselves on call more or less all the time, but may work as few as 10 hours in a given week. And yet, if they're not available when the employer wants them, they may not get called the next time. Imagine paying child care with that situation. Many of these workers are mothers. Immigrants today in New York make up 37% of the city's population, 37%, and if you include the second generation, kids of immigrants, 55%, more than half of the city's population is either foreign-born or their parents are. Unlike Los Angeles, where I spent a lot of years, the national origins of the immigrant population here are extremely diverse. No one group dominates, which is actually a challenge for organizing in some respects because people speak many different languages and so on. But what we have found in the research I've done and others have done is that in general, there are exceptions for sure. Immigrants are more interested in the kind of organizing we study than US foreign workers tend to be on the average. And I think there are a lot of reasons for that. One is immigration itself. Most people come for economic reasons. They're trying to find a better life for themselves and their families. And so if someone offers a helping hand to help you improve your pay and working conditions and job prospects, that's extremely welcome. That's all. Maybe we can talk about that later in more detail if you want. This is a thing that surprises many people because people assume that, especially undocumented immigrants, are so fearful and so on, which is true. But nevertheless, they are have proved unexpectedly organizable in recent years. And of course, not all immigrants are undocumented. In this city, only about a sixth of the total immigrant population is without papers. It's much higher in LA, actually, which I know more than you want to know about. And immigrants vary enormously, too, in their skill levels, educational levels, and so on. So, but our focus is on the bottom of the labor market, therefore the less skilled immigrants who often are trapped in low-wage, precarious jobs as domestic workers, laborers, restaurant dishwashers, street vendors, taxi drivers, and so on. And those are the occupations we study. It's important to know, though, that immigrants who have moved who've been in the US for a while, often do move up into the better jobs in the labor market. And we found in our unionization study, like the one that's coming out on Tuesday, but year after year we have found this, that those who arrived before 1990, so that's now 25 years ago almost, have higher unionization rates than native-born workers in the United States. Again, reflecting that wish for economic advancement. Not that everyone doesn't want to advance economically, but I think immigrants have more motivation than the average person. So that has made New York a very fertile soil for the kind of organizing that new labor, as we call it, has taken up. The fact that there is such a large immigrant population with high economic aspirations. And also often, this varies from country to country, but many immigrants come with a more collectivist orientation, a sense that their fate is bound up with the fate of their community, which in famously individualist US culture is more unusual. So that helps too in terms of receptivity to already mentioned the philanthropy factor. 20 of the largest grant-making foundations in the country, 100 largest, sorry, are here in New York, which is home to 3% of the population, so it's way above that level, 20 out of, it's 20% versus 3%. And again, only Washington has more lawyers than New York, which I know is a mixed blessing, but in this area, it's a very good thing. Okay, so finally, what are these new forms of organizing that I've been alluding to? Worker centers are the term, is the sort of umbrella term that's used for many of these groups. There are now over 200 of them in the United States, and 37 here in New York. That's the single largest concentration of these groups in the country. And what do? They organize workers to some extent, and they advocate for workers. And most of all, they shine a bright light on abuses. These are not labor unions. They don't have the deep pockets that many unions still have despite their decline. Their staff are paid almost nothing. They live foundation grant, paycheck to paycheck. They do not have the resources to organize thousands and thousands of workers in most cases, but they're extremely skilled at calling public and media attention to abuses. Many of them are staffed by very young, highly educated, either lawyers or other people with a lot of training who have figured out how to do this very effectively. So groups like Make the Road New York, another one that we profile, you've probably run into some of this stuff, the Restaurant Opportunities Committee and so on. And they mostly organize in sectors that unions, traditional unions, have abandoned or neglected. For example, the restaurant industry in this city used to be pretty highly unionized. Now, a few high-end restaurants and some of the Jewish delis remain unionized, and hotel restaurants, that's about it. So this is a wide open field, and Restaurant Opportunities Committee has begun to fill the gap. Domestic workers were never organized, but Domestic Workers United has, intervened in that area. The taxi workers is an interesting case of an occupation that, again, was once highly unionized, became de-unionized. Most taxi workers are now either independent contractors or leasing a cab. And the Taxi Workers Alliance, sometimes called the Tired Workers Alliance, has been extremely effective in not only organizing taxi drivers, but also intervening in this is a highly regulated industry in the city, although we'll see what Uber brings and so on, but for the moment. And they've been extremely able at intervening in the regulatory process and making sure that drivers get some share of any fare increases and so on. Some of the groups organize along ethnic lines. And one that we studied is Minkwon, which is a Korean workers organization in Queens that focuses on Korean immigrants. Others recruit workers that are not at the very bottom of the labor market. You've probably all seen the subway signs for the Freelancers Union, for example, which is middle strata workers, but it's the same kind of organization, and that's another one of our cases. So typically what these groups do is they focus on things like wage theft and other violations of the law. Many also engage in immigrant rights advocacy. You can see already the importance of the law here and of lawyers. Again, they've been much more successful, I would say, at the discursive level, if you will. That's an academic term, but what I mean is they've changed the conversation, just as Occupy Wall Street did. They made people aware of these abuses, but they have not been as successful in putting an end to them. So that's the work that remains to be done. The most hopeful thing in terms of the future of that, in my view, is the increasing collaboration between traditional unions and these groups. So it's still kind of limited, but compared to how things started when these groups first emerged, things have really progressed. When these groups first emerged, the attitude of the traditional unions was, who are these kids? They are mostly very young, but unlike labor leaders, the advocates who lead these organizations. A lot of them are women who also work for those miserable salaries, right? It's very noticeable that many are read by women. And anyway, so there was this sort of big, sort of wariness on the part of organized labor, like, they don't have any money, they don't know what they're doing, how are they going to do anything? And similarly, the worker center staff, the leaders and many of the workers involved themselves thought, these unions are dinosaurs, they have no idea how to deal with the kind of conditions we're facing in the restaurant industry or in retail or whatever. Retail action project is another one, by the way, I should have mentioned. So that wariness on both sides meant there was a lot of mutual suspicion and sort of, not necessarily publicly, but sort of trashing each other. over the years, and these groups have now been around for a couple of decades, many of them, they've won the respect of unions because they have been successful at the level of changing the conversation increasingly, which unions are not very good at. And the unions continue to decline and begin to see that they have to do something different. The old formula isn't working, and have begun to embrace these groups. And the groups themselves, in their quest for finding some kind of model that would allow them to go on for many years rather than for the next 6 months with the grace grant they got, you know, are beginning to appreciate the virtues of permanent organization, which, you know, unions offer a model for, at least historically and increasingly today. So we're beginning to see, am I running out of time? Okay, let me just try to wrap up. I'm sorry, I could go on forever, as you can imagine. Anyway, we began to see some much more collaboration between the two, and there are examples in the book. I won't bore you with those. Let me just try to wrap up by saying that I think this is among the more hopeful challenges to the market fundamentalism that I mentioned at the beginning. These groups really do shine a bright light on the plight of the most disadvantaged people in the workforce. And insofar as, you know, the kind of reigning orthodoxy that the market is the answer to everything, I think they offer very convincing evidence that that is not the case and have, you know, opened the hearts and minds of many people to the need to do this. Let me just close by mentioning one of the more interesting developments, which I noticed is your fund for today, or what, I forget what it's called in the program, the Fast Food Forward, what is the name of it? Fast Food Forward, I know, but anyway, it's your fundraising candidate for today. That is just the kind of collaboration I was talking about. So it's now been embraced by the Service Employees International Union. You remember those fast food strikes that broke out a couple years ago? Right. With a straight line from Occupy Wall Street, I must say, but we don't have time to get into that. So we could argue about how grassroots it ever was, but anyway, it started as a worker center initiative and now is embraced by one of the largest unions in the country, the Service SEIU, which brought us the Justice for Janitors campaigns and some others and has a lot of experience organizing low-wage workers. That's the kind of collaboration I had in mind, and I think that's a very helpful sign for the future, because if you could marry the imagination of the worker centers with the resources of the traditional unions, maybe that will be fruitful and multiplied. I'm not a religious person, but you know what I'm trying to say. So let me just stop there and I'm happy to answer some questions.
Hi. When you spoke about business hostility and government indifference to supporting unions, workers' rights, I think that's what you're talking about. What I was struck by also was the sort of the lack of popular support. And I remember reading an article that suggested that when liberals sort of stopped supporting unions as much and started focusing more on the rights of minorities and such like, that there was a decline in power on the left of the political spectrum. But what I'm struck by is that there were two developments. One, I heard that among original supporters of unions, there was real question as to whether public sector unions, for instance, were a good idea. And I think for a person who's not a union person, doesn't have a history, and is good-hearted and wishes well and all that, there's a little bit of a feeling sometimes that sort of politicians and union leaders collude to sort of take money from taxpayers, and that's then you hear stories, and maybe these are, you know, there's one in a million, but you hear sometimes about sort of bad teachers, for instance, who are being protected, and there's this, I feel an anguish, like why are the unions, why does it have to become students versus unions, or what, so there's that element. So I just wanted to know if you could, I guess the third piece is that it's no longer the case. With low-wage workers, it may still be the case. But now I think many private, it's no longer the case that if you work for the government, you're giving up, you know, income and security and things, benefits, for the sake of sort of serving the public. I think a lot of private sector people now look at public sector employees and feel like, I wish I had a deal like that. And so all those elements seem to me to undermine the popular support and call for organizing. So I was just wondering if you could address that.
Sure, that's a really good point. So I think what you're pointing to, which I totally agree with, is the political isolation that public sector unions in particular now face. Even here in New York, but it's even more true in places like Wisconsin, and you know about the new collective bargaining laws there. So I would just say a couple of things. Yeah, this is, as private sector employers have taken away the benefits that they used to offer many workers, especially things like pensions. And the things that people envy of public sector workers are not their pay usually, it's the benefits, which very few people have anymore in the private sector, right? And this is a result of union decline. But it has also led to the isolation of public sector unions and increasingly vicious attacks on them. I'm sorry to put it this way because I know you mean completely well, but you have to understand that the attacks that you're hearing on teachers' unions and so on are very calculated. They're brought to you by the Koch brothers and people like that. I mean, they are literally funding and organizing those campaigns. I mean, there's lots of evidence out there. I could tell you more later if you're interested. But it does strike a chord with many members of the public who may not know the whole historical background and whatnot. And because union density in the private sector has gone so low, instead of feeling like, we should organize to get what those people have, the sense is like, this isn't fair, I don't have anything, and they have all this, why are they going on strike, right? Which is what you're pointing to. But I would just urge you to think about the sort of bigger historical picture to make sense out of that and to not fall for the propaganda which is out there. There are some real issues too, though. I don't want to minimize those.
I can't get it back for.
Can you speak out loud enough? Yeah, Barbara.
Yeah, I just want to sort of say that I grew up in Northern England, we're lower class, all my family were in unions, and my first experience with unions was going to the union hall and listening to art history lectures. And that caused me to go into art history and become an art, and then I became lots of other things. But I just want to just say that, you know, they offer the most incredible education. That's all.
I wish that was still true and as true in the U.S., but there are some parallels here in New York. So you may know about the Red Roses Project of 1199, and just also art-oriented. And it's true, the unions don't do enough labor education, but we are trying at Murphy, if you know any young people or union members who are looking to learn more about all these things, that's what we try to do, though we're not part of the labor movement in the official way.
You address the issue of adjunctization, particularly acute.
Sure. Thank you. Yeah, I'm not too much about that, actually. I'm sure her question was about adjuncts at the university. It's not just at CUNY, but CUNY has had that for a long time. You know, I used to teach at CUNY in the 80s, and then I went to California, and then I came back, and even in the 80s, there were lots of adjuncts in my department. So it's not a new phenomenon, but nationally, it's growing like crazy, and it's a perfect example of precarious labor, not at the bottom of the labor market, although it is like the bottom. I can tell you from personal knowledge that at CUNY, if you teach a course as an adjunct, you get paid about $3,000 or $4,000 at the most, depending on your experience and qualifications. That's ridiculous. And that's just not okay. So this is a huge issue and part of a bigger crisis of higher education. If you put that together with online learning, so-called, which to me is an oxymoron, I have to say, but, higher education is facing a deep crisis and both of those things are economically attractive in an era where everybody's complaining about the rising cost of college. Administrators cannot resist either one of them, but it's really destroying the university as we know it, in my view. That's not probably what you asked, but that's not
true. No, I understand.
Sure. A fairly simple question. It's about health care. They go along with this. You didn't seem to address this. And this has created a tremendous amount of these problems.
Healthcare, and say a little bit more about what the problems you're referring to are.
Healthcare, in the fact is, it's become too expensive, it doesn't work, and it's a disaster in this country.
Right, so how is that connected to the labor question?
You were talking about benefits and stuff like that. That's deteriorated, except for Congress, who has the best policy anybody could want.
It's true. I mean, and unionized workers usually have some kind of employer-provided health care, though that has deteriorated some. It's still way better than for many other people, which I think adds to the dynamic that the gentleman over there was talking about. So it is tangled up with this issue. You're right. I'm sorry, I didn't know, 20 minutes or something, so much on the cover.
Terry.
I agree.
I know from the sociological point of view, you're looking for structural reasons and for institutional reasons. There is a tendency, however, in the popular press especially, to either blame or praise individuals, especially political leadership. People blame inequality, for example, on the era of Bloomberg. And even though it's true, it's not the entire story. But the question is, we elected a mayor recently who gave us hope that inequality would be the top of his list of priorities, and that would necessarily involve some sort of improvement in the climate for unions. It has with public service unions who never got to negotiate before that. I guess I'm asking a kind of ethical, psychological question. Are you more hopeful now in the epoch of de Blasio that things will move in a direction that are more just and fair?
I guess I'm hopeful within limits. I think we can think back to 2008 when Barack Obama became president of the United States on a slogan of hope, and all of us, well, many of us, drank the Kool-Aid, I certainly did, and things have not changed so much in regard to these kinds of issues. So there are big constraints facing Obama, and unfortunately there are some facing de Blasio too. I mean, I'm sure, I am hopeful that it will be an improvement over the last 12 years, but, or even longer perhaps, but I think there's limits to what's possible. For, you know, one person can't change the entire structure. So thank you for pointing that out. On the public sector side, though, I get paid quite well, so I'm not an adjunct or anything, so I'm not complaining. But when my union has not had a new contract the entire time I've been back in New York since late 2009, and some of them have now, you know, been settled. But there's a big backlog of accumulation, and I know the people who are envious of public sector benefits are not too sympathetic to this, but it's hard for those workers too. So they are unionized, but it's a hollowed out kind of unionism to some extent because of this problem.
We'll just take two more. A back here. A back. I don't think we can get the mic too.
I believe in the union movement. I think this economy will never be humane or fair without a strong movement. But we have to look at some of the factors that the unions themselves have inflicted upon their own growth. One is in terms of corruption. There's been a lot of corruption in unions. In terms of health, they have a certain kind of fiefdom so that they want to protect the benefits that they've worked out in collective bargaining and have interfered with universal health care. One of the things that really I think the public is turning off the unions about is the fact that they overprotect poor functioning workers. And that's a big problem. And I think that's a factor in a lot of situations where they refuse to join the union.
You're right, 90% right, in my view, at least, maybe more. The corruption issue is there. I have to say it's particularly true here in New York. I've never heard the term mobbed up in reference to unions so much since I got back here. And I mean, it's an issue in some cases. I might point out that there's plenty of corruption in other sectors of this country, too. It's not just unions, so keep that in mind. But, you know, people are people. There is that problem. Sorry, I'm trying to remember the rest of what you said. About the healthcare thing. No, that's right. Now, so I guess the reason we tried to focus in our project on the worker centers and low-wage workers is that it's sort of a reminder of why these groups emerged in the first place. All the issues you're raising really are not, don't come up at the bottom of the labor market. And I hear all the time people in audiences like this say things like, well, you know, yeah, we needed unions 100 years ago, but we don't anymore. They're just protecting all these fat cats, that kind of thing. And that's not completely untrue in certain sectors of the economy, but I don't think anyone could argue that about something like the taxi workers or the retail workers or, you know. And so I think, in a way, this is a bringing the labor movement back to its original roots, what we call new labor and alt labor. And I at least am hopeful that some of the problems that you address will be resolved by a revitalization of the bottom of the labor market, which is where this organization is really needed. So I mean, we could talk for a long time about those specific issues that you mentioned, and some of it is media manipulation, but some of it's real, definitely.
One last question. I guess right.
I am very curious to hear your perspective on a future social movement. We see throughout the course of history that there are these waxing and waning severe economic declines followed by an uprising of some kind. And I'm wondering if you can prognosticate in some ways, tell us what your own intuitions are.
Well, I do hesitate to prognosticate, as you put it, but I do feel hopeful about a couple of things. I did a study with some of my colleagues at CUNY of Occupy Wall Street, and one of the things that was very striking in looking at that was that what are often called the millennials, that generation of 20-somethings, that my own son, maybe some of you have children or grandchildren of that age, they fueled that movement, and they're fueling a lot of other things too right now. The dreamers, the immigrant kids who are, you know, trying to advance the cause of immigration reform are also mostly millennials. I don't know about Ferguson, but the Dream Defenders in Florida, you know, young people are also the ones who lead social movements, right? If you look at the data on that generation, it is actually very inspiring and hopeful. They are way to the left of older folks, sorry, most of us in the room. On almost any issue you name, not just same-sex marriage, which everybody knows, or marijuana, or that unions, actually. They, if you ask them what they think of capitalism, they are more negative than their elders. Really, immigration reform, all those issues. And they are beginning to stir. I think Occupy was the most dramatic example of that, but there are others. So that's what makes me feel like getting up in the morning. You know, I feel like that's the hope, is that generation. You know, who knows what they'll do. It's too dangerous to really make predictions, but that's what's keeping me going, is thinking about that.